Simon & Schuster Audio presents This Messy, Magnificent Life, A Field Guide by Geneen Roth. Read by the author.
Prologue, Dropping the Me Project. From the beginning, I was always more anxious than the average bear. I was told at various times that I was too sensitive, too emotional, too female, too big, too curious, too demanding, too intense. The adults somehow forgot to mention that I was also sassy, silly, and keen-eyed. Regrettably, gaining and losing the same 15 pounds every few weeks did not improve my self-worth. So at age 24, I started looking for a way to handle the full catastrophe, as Zorba the Greek described living. At the start, during the 80s, my focus was on untangling misguided beliefs about food. Along with most women who struggled with their weight, I believed that if I could resolve what seemed to be the source of my self-hatred, I would be thin, happy, free. It made so much sense. Take away the source of the pain, and the pain will go away, leaving a bright spirit in its place. As I lost weight, I quickly understood that issues with food were cover-ups. Yes, they needed to be addressed on the physical level, otherwise they could turn into more serious illnesses. And yes, most of us needed to learn what our bodies longed for and needed because we'd been brainwashed into craving junk. But the genesis of compulsive eating was not physical. And unless its source was addressed, a range of equally painful behaviors would emerge. When my misery with food ended and didn't change anything except the size of my thighs, I kept trying to fix other broken parts of myself by immersing myself in therapy, intensive meditation retreats, and rigorous spiritual practices. Now, I think of these last 30 years as similar to the wandering period in the Buddha's life, minus a few essentials like his willingness to sleep on nails and eat one measly grain of rice a day. Furthermore, it took him 29 years less than me to catch on to the truth. In my own case, it was only recently that I was willing to relinquish the Me Project and stop trying to fix what had never been broken. I'd tried versions of not fixing myself before, but always with the secret hope that not fixing myself would fix me. This time, I wanted only one thing, to be at home in my mind and life as I knew it. I used the same practices I'd used to end my suffering with food. If being vigilant about stopping the harshness with which I treated myself had unraveled the most obsessive behavior pattern of my life, if allowing my full range of feelings without acting on them had dismantled my suffering with food, why wouldn't it dismantle what caused it? The ongoing, low-level discontent of what it felt like to be me. And finally, if being resolute about feeding myself with awareness and a large dose of kindness changed how I ate, why wouldn't it change how I lived? What if, as I once did and still do with food, I could live as if nothing was broken, nothing was missing, while nonetheless questioning the constellation of beliefs that led to anxiety, isolation, and self-hatred? What if I believed what Zen teacher Shunryu Suzuki said, that we are all perfect and that we need some improvement? Or as they say in Texas, God loves you exactly the way you are, and she loves you too much to let you stay like this. This Messy, Magnificent Life is about the path I followed and the obstacles I encountered along the way. It also challenges the conviction that everyday ease and freedom, no matter what the external situation, are reserved for the very few. That is, not for poor, doomed, little match girl, moi. The book starts where women, food, and God ended, around the table, because the way we eat is always a primary gateway to the mind that creates the suffering about it. My ongoing work with retreat students, their stories, and their breathtaking changes continues to provide a groundwork for not only the work with food, but also with an assortment of everyday doorways like illness, anxiety, hatred, misogyny, intimate relationships, and the guy paying with change in the express line. This messy, magnificent life chronicles the shift from feeling as if we are secretly defective, helpless, and too often walking on the barbed wire of our thoughts, to waking up with the ever-present, always sublime freedom from our incessantly restless minds right in the middle of ordinary life. Freedom from mental suffering is not a mystery, but a willingness to examine what keeps us from directly experiencing the deep blue peace and quiet joy that are always accessible and forever unaffected by the passing show. If the drama and chaos in the outside world are expressions of the minds that create them, then naming and questioning the way we live in these minds and on this earth is the only way that true change can happen. And so we begin. Part 1. Around the Table. Chapter 1. Mana. I am making a cup of tea in my favorite purple-flowered mug when I smell smoke. I look through the windows behind me and see plumes of smoke through the trees. I call the fire department, and they tell me there's a fire down the road, that it's not contained, and that we might have to evacuate our home. They'll let me know. My husband, Matt, is away. He never seems to be around during the panoply of biblical California disasters, earthquakes, fires, mudslides. So I will have to deal with this myself. My heart races. I feel panicked. But then I think, this will be fine. Sometimes bad is good. I remember a haiku by Zen master Masahide that I read just yesterday. Barns burnt down. Now I can see the moon. Since I have the luxury of time, I walk around the house looking at the things we've accumulated. My mother's antique Bombay chest, doors from Bali, a cabinet from Japan. The photographs of Matt and me at our wedding, of my mother and me at my twin nephew's bar mitzvahs last year. I put 5 framed pictures and 3 photo albums in a pile near the front door. I walk into my closet and I look around, a bit dazed. All these clothes. The only time my father hinted that he knew he was dying was a few weeks after he was diagnosed with stage 4 lymphoma when we were walking past his closet. He said, "My clothes. What's going to happen to all my clothes?" As if they had lives of their own and would miss his legs, his arms, his wrists, or had meaning beyond his insatiable hunger for things and his inability to understand the meaning of enough. I look blankly at my shoes, my sweaters, my pants. If our house burns down and I am left with only the clothing I take now, what would I want? What can't I live without? I finger an embroidered jacket, think about throwing it in my car, but then I realize I haven't worn it in a year, and although it was once my favorite piece of clothing, it isn't now. I leave it hanging next to the black wool jacket with the short sleeves and the distressed gray corduroy jacket. I call my neighbor Susan, whose husband is a volunteer firefighter, to find out if she knows anything more about the fire. "What fire?" she asks, voice rising. And then Susan begins to scream. "I'm in a wheelchair. I'm alone. I've just had back surgery. I can't move." I find myself thinking of the movie Sorry, Wrong Number, when the wheelchair-bound Barbara Stanwyck overhears a plan to commit a murder that turns out to be her own. But I keep this thought to myself. I tell Susan I'll pick her up if we need to evacuate. I move slowly, as if underwater. I put jewelry in a backpack, my wedding ring, my father's Masonic ring that he wore until the day he died, my grandmother's earring.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.